Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Your Platform, a program that gives you an opportunity as a member of the public to air views on things that are affecting you. Now, did you know that you can complain of poor service delivery when you are not satisfied? Did you also know that you can complain or call for a refund when a product is not in good condition or defective? On Your Platform today, we focus our attention on consumer rights. I am your presenter, Macpherson Mkuka. Stay tuned. This is Your Platform, and this time around I'm now joined by Webster Benkele, a taxi driver. He's going to share with us what he knows about his rights as a consumer. Mr. Benkele, welcome to Your Platform.
Welcome, sir.
What do you know about consumer rights?
Consumer rights, for what? I just know a bit.
What is that you know about your rights as a consumer?
My right as a consumer, when I buy something in a shop, that thing is maybe rotten, or I take it wrongly, I need to take it back to that shop.
What are some of the rights you know as a consumer?
We have the right to return our products if we're not happy. We have the right to complain over service, over how we are treated as customers. Those are some of the rights I know.
Precious, welcome to Your Platform.
Thank you.
Tell us, what do you know about consumer rights?
Okay, consumer rights are the rights which when I'm not satisfied with the product, maybe I enter the shop, maybe I'm not satisfied with the prices, or maybe they have displayed expired goods, I can report that to consumer protector, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Makasa, welcome to Your Platform.
Thank you so much.
Do tell us, what do you know about consumer rights?
What I know about consumer rights is that as a consumer, a person that is buying products from different places, I've got certain rights which are supposed to protect me from whatever it is that I've bought. And this is directly in line with the purchases that I may be able to do. It may be, for instance, in this particular case, maybe I may look at the shop if I'm buying groceries and everything. So there are certain rights that consumers have in regards to the products that they get. Are they getting the right product? Is the product okay and not expired? So these are the rights that protect the consumers from unnecessary exploitation in certain cases.
And what are some of these rights that you think you have as a consumer?
As a consumer, I've got the right. If, for example, I buy something from a shop and I discover later on that it's expired, I've got the right to actually return the product, because I'm supposed to get something that is within the period that it should be consumed. So as a consumer, I've got the right to demand for a replacement of the right product that is not expired.
Have you ever experienced any infringement of any of your rights as a consumer?
In certain cases, yes, I have experienced such a thing, where sometimes you may buy a product and realize that the product that you got is actually expired. So in such an instance, as a consumer, I've had the right, I've taken back the particular product to the respective people that have taken responsibility, and having not realized that they were selling something that was expired, so I've been actually refunded, or they've actually given me a replacement.
In case of the trader or the seller saying they cannot refund you, do you know where exactly to report?
Yes, in a scenario, and which I'm sure happens most of the times to a lot of consumers, where they can buy something and then they return and they're told that no, you can't return because you already bought. Personally, I know where to go, which is the consumer rights protection, where I can be able to go and then lodge in my complaint about the particular place where I got this particular product. And those should be the people to help me actually get back my return of the particular product that I got. And actually, by law, it is actually an offence, which can have other people prosecuted. So I think it's important that people have the knowledge and know where they can go in an event of such a thing happening, because this commission is there actually to protect the people from such exploitation.
Still watching your platform, and this time around I'm joined by Jimmy Banda, another taxi driver. Mr. Banda, welcome to your platform.
Very welcome, sir.
Today we are looking at consumer rights. As a consumer, what do you know about your rights?
If I go to the shop, I go and buy something, like a spare part. Sometimes you go and buy some plugs. You come and put it in your car. The car can't start. You take those plugs, you take it back, there they go and refuse. They say, no, you have changed these plugs. These are not the plugs which you have bought from this shop. So us, whom we are not educated, we can't do anything, you see. So that's the problem we are finding in these things.
So do you know where to report in case of such a thing happens to you?
No, we don't know where to go. We just know where to go to the police station. And there the police, they say, no, go and find the authorities which they look on these things. And we don't know where to go.
Jason Kabwe, welcome to your platform.
Thank you very much.
What do you know about consumer rights?
Consumer rights, basically how I look at it is where a client or a consumer knows exactly about their rights, the well-going of the products, or what they really have to benefit from the services.
And what are some of those rights that you know as a consumer?
Basically, as a consumer, I believe one has the right to inspect a product before they actually buy it, because that's a right. You cannot buy something, for example, which is expired. That's a right. You have a right to buy something that is of good standards, that you feel is okay to be consumed.
Have you ever experienced a situation where you go to a shop, you buy something, it's not good, you try to refund, they tell you no?
Yes. Quite on several times I've done that. I remember way back, I think if I would go 2 years back, I remember buying a battery and it wasn't okay. I went back, I told the general manager saying, can I have a refund? They refused. I ended up going to consumer protection, right? I had told them saying this is what happened, and the good part is that I was refunded.
What could be your message to your fellow consumers with regards to knowing their rights?
It's very, very important as a consumer to know your rights. Reason being is that you do not need to be undermined, or you get a product that you're not really comfortable with. You have to get something that you feel is going to be okay with you. So it's very important that you know your right as a consumer, and that if you're not satisfied with a product, you go up and express yourself.
I was dealing with a hardware store, and they told me that they couldn't collect back the product. They could only give me credit to spend on something else in the store, which I did not want. I didn't want anything else in the store. I just wanted my money back, because what I wanted, when I got it, it wasn't what I wanted. And then they told me that I can't exchange it. And they made the process so complex, telling me I need to go to their head office, speak to this person. It wasn't very simple.
So there is one time I entered into a certain shop. They displayed it was expired beef. So when I took it back, in fact, it was not expired. It was rotten. It was bad. So when I took it, in fact, I was given a good product.
Thank you. You're still watching Your Platform, a program that gives you an opportunity to air your views on things that are affecting you as a community. This time around, I'm joined by Mr. Brian Lingela, who is Director of Consumer Protection at the Competition Consumer Protection Commission, CCPC. Mr. Lingela, welcome to Your Platform.
Thank you so much.
Do tell us, what is Competition Consumer Protection Commission?
The Competition and Consumer Protection Commission is a statutory government agency created by Act Number 24 of the Competition and Consumer Protection Act. It has two principal objectives. The first one is to safeguard competition in all sectors of the economy, ensuring that the competition process is safeguarded and that no business is engaged in anti-competitive trade practices. Secondly, it is the objective of the Commission, CCPC, to protect consumers from unfair trading practices in all market segments of the economy.
What is the role of CCPC in consumer protection?
The role of a commission in a situation like that one is to investigate a particular complaint that we notice in the market, or indeed that is brought to us by the commission. For example, somebody goes and buys something which is defective. It is the right of the consumer to demand a replacement, that they be given a product that works, or indeed a product that is not expired. And so consumers should be able to exercise the right to demand for a replacement, or in the event that there is no replacement, a refund of their hard-earned money. And in the event that the trader does not oblige, that is where now the commission comes in. The consumer has a right to redress, and they are able then to lodge a complaint with the commission. You may say, well, why doesn't the commission, you know, become proactive? The simple reason is that it is a consumer that is affected right in the market where the commission is not present. So unless and until the consumer themselves who are affected in the market report to the commission, then it becomes difficult for the commission to get involved. So consumers should know that they have a right to seek redress, first of all, at the point that they encounter the supply of those defective products, or indeed expired products. Although for expired product, the commission does not compromise, because that is a criminal offense. When you look at Section 52, subsection 1, of the Competition and Consumer Protection Act, it prohibits a person or an enterprise from supplying products that do not meet the safety standard for the class of goods that have been classified either by the Zambia Bureau of Standards or indeed by any other competent agency. And in this case, the Public Health Act, CAP 295 of the laws of Zambia, and the Food and Drugs Act, CAP 303 of the laws of Zambia. And that particular provision in the Competition and Consumer Protection Act is actually criminal. And in the event that a consumer lodges a complaint with the commission for having been supplied with an expired product, that trader is liable, you know, to be prosecuted. And we have, as a matter of fact, prosecuted a good number of enterprises for supplying consumers with the expired product.
But the bottom line is that consumers need to be vigilant as well. There are a number of situations where consumers just walk into a retail outlet and they just pick the product that they want without checking as to whether the product has expired or not, or whether the best before date is fast approaching. So consumers also have a responsibility to ensure that they do not purchase products that have expired, or indeed those that are defective. And this is very common in this country, particularly with regard to electrical and electronic appliances, which to a larger extent we import from other countries. And it's at a point where the consumer purchases this product and they begin to use it, that they discover that in fact it doesn't work accordingly.
How often are you on the ground to sensitize the members of the public on the need for them to know their rights?
This is a very ongoing program. Sensitization is very key to us. In actual fact, one of our principal objectives or functions is to provide information to consumers regarding their rights under the Act. And we have been conducting a lot of sensitization programs. We have been doing a lot of provincial tours where we have been going from district to district, conducting road shows using popular musicians. We just had a team that was in Southern Province 2 weeks ago, sensitizing consumers. We have been doing market sensitizations. At district level, markets are very popular spots where business is conducted, where there's a lot of interaction between consumers and businesses throughout the country. You may wish to know that the commission now has office presence in all the 10 provinces of the country, and this is at provincial level. So we have been using the provincial offices to conduct awareness at district level. One of the recent strategies that we have embarked upon is a sensitization of chiefdoms. You will agree with me that these are people who, when they have disposable income, they travel to the boma or to town after harvest. We are currently in the harvest period, so people are going after they have harvested. They sell their produce in town and they want to go back home, perhaps with a solar kit so that they can have a light. And it's at that point that they encounter, you know, this kind of unfair trading. And so we think that the people that live in villages, rural areas as well, are important consumers in this country, and that they should also be sensitized. But what we have also done is that we use a lot of radio and television. Community radio particularly is very important. We have translated our sensitization materials into the 7 major languages that are spoken on radio throughout the country. We have developed spot announcements regarding the need for consumers to be alert as they interact with traders and service providers in the market. But what beyond that, also we think that we need to begin the sensitization program at a time when people are still young, and so we have introduced school clubs that talk about, you know, competition and consumer protection issues in secondary schools. And currently, we we have 185 school clubs spread across the country. So these children engage in debates, quizzes around these important topics, essay competition, and so on and so forth. We use the drama, which has proven to be very, very important in sensitizing people across the country. So we are using a number of strategies, but as you will appreciate, sensitization is an ongoing process, because violations will keep occurring, and it is important that we also continue sensitizing people. We do not have, unfortunately, a culture of complaining in this country for a long time, but I think that it is changing for the better, because people are losing quite a lot of money through unfair trading practices. Just last year, 2015 alone, we recovered on behalf of consumers up to 1.5 million kwacha in product refunds and replacements. This is money that could have been lost to different traders and providers of services hadn't the commission intervened on behalf of the consumer. So sensitization is an ongoing process, and I don't think we'll reach a point where we will say, well, now everyone has been sensitized, they know about their rights and obligations. This is an ongoing process, and the commission will keep improving on its strategies to ensure that as many people as possible are aware about their rights, but also obligations.
As someone who drives, also there are instances where you go to a car park in case you don't have, probably you don't have space at home to park your vehicle, or at work you go to a car park, you pay, then they tell you are parking at your own risk. How do you look at such an issue?
Well, I think that is not only in a car park, actually it's something that you find anywhere else. Most of the places they would actually advise that whatever you're doing is at owner's risk. I want to think that if you have left your vehicle in the custody of other people, they should be able to take responsibility for the particular vehicle that they, you have left there. So as a person that is going to park there, I think I have, I should have the privilege and the right to be protected in cases of theft, to be protected in cases of vandalism or anything like that. So I think that either if we have a law, I think it needs to be reinforced, or if there isn't any law to protect people that can leave things in hands of other people, I think there is need that a lot of sensitization is done on that. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
What do you think of the situation where car parks display a disclaimer to say when you park at your own risk, meanwhile you pay them?
As for me, that's not good. Because that's a park-up, the car park. So when I pay, those people, they should be responsible of looking after maybe my car. So if anything happened, it shouldn't be on my own risk. It should be their risk also. They should take charge of that. I've even seen that on the tickets. When you go to Intercity, you look at the ticket, then you are told when you lose a luggage, it is on your own risk, which is not fair. Because we're, in fact, when we put those luggages, we pay for them. So why should it be on my own list? Meanwhile, I've paid for that thing.
Thank you so much, Precious.
Okay, you're welcome.
Parking at own risk. Now, in the first place, I think really if one is parking at their own risk, then what's the bigger question I'd ask is then why should one pay if you're parking at your own risk? Because for you paying, I believe that money is actually used for safety. So there must be a person that is looking after your vehicle. So why should you park at your own risk when you're paying? Unless if it's free, yes, I'm going to park at my own risk. But if I'm paying, that's a service. Somebody has to look after what I'm paying for.
So now, you do park at car parks and you park at your own risk. How do you look at such a thing?
Well, unfortunately, I wouldn't call that ignorance, but where somebody tells me I'm supposed to park at my own risk, trust me, I wouldn't do that. I would not go for that. I would rather maybe park the vehicle where I would take care of it myself, not at my own risk.
Thank you so much, Jason.
All right, thank you very much.
I think that's them looking after themselves, not wanting to be more liable than they already are. I think obviously they do have some care, but them saying that it's not their own risk, it is because they've taken money from us, so it must be they have to take some responsibility. But I feel it's wrong that they say that it's at our own risk when we're paying the money to park our cars there. So I feel that's wrong and that needs to be looked at.
Thank you so much.
Sure. Thank you.
You're still watching your platform and we continue talking to Mr. Brian Lingela, who is Director of Consumer Protection at the Competition Consumer Protection Commission, CCPC. This time around, we are looking at the issue of disclaimers being displayed at some car parks, saying you park at your own risk, meanwhile you pay some fee to park that car in that car park. Have you ever received any complaint from a member of the public with regards to such a particular complaint?
That is a very good question and observation. That is a disclaimer which is prohibited under section 48, subsection 1 of the Competition and Consumer Protection Act. And basically this provision prohibits an owner or an occupier of a business premise from displaying disclaimers that purport to disclaim liability. You know, and these things basically disadvantage the consumer because in the event that something happens to a motor vehicle, then what they are saying in effect is that they are not liable. But this is contrary to what the law says. The example you have given basically addresses the fact that this is a business concern that is making profit and they are collecting fees from members of the public in order to provide the parking service at a fee and at a profit. To a larger extent, this is an illegal practice. So for all those car park owners that are in the business of providing car parking services at a fee, you cannot disclaim liability and display the disclaimer to the effect that a vehicle owner will park at their own risk. And this is simply because that is what your core business is. You are providing that service at a fee. People are paying for the sole purpose that you are going to ensure the security of their motor vehicle. So I like to urge such business people to desist from this practice of disclaiming, of displaying those disclaimer, because they are illegal, and as a matter of fact, it is punishable under the law by way of a fine. The maximum fine that we can impose is actually 10% of your annual turnover. So what we'll do is that we'll ask for your books of account and see what turnover you have over the past 1 year, and then we'll be able to determine a fine. This basically disadvantages the consumer. It is illegal. People should desist. Failure to which they will be fined.
How often do you receive complaints from people acquiring car park services of such nature?
We have not received such complaints where perhaps a motor vehicle has been broken into, and it's been broken into, and the service provider is refusing to provide some kind of a redress. Those incidences we have not recorded so far, but the commonest kind of disclaimers that we receive are those that we find in retail outlets, where it says, you know, no return, no refund. You know, once bought cannot be refunded or exchanged, and we are fined a lot of traders in that regard.
Why do you think there are fewer complaints in that regard?
Well, it could be, but on the other hand, it could be that those service providers may be providing the necessary redress. But what I must say is that mere display of such disclaimers is actually illegal. And in the event that there are some consumers that may not know, please be aware that if you see such a disclaimer displayed in a place where you are parking the vehicle at a fee, those things are illegal. Please, we are not everywhere ourselves, but consumers are everywhere, and I would like to appeal to you to please report to the commission. But there are also other disclaimers which are put in public places, such as car parks, perhaps at a hotel or restaurants. Those are treated differently because the hotel is not in the core business of providing a parking service. Their core business is to provide, you know, the hotel hospitality services. And parking, therefore, is provided only, you know, for the convenience of the matron or patron, but not as a core business. The same thing applies to those disclaimers in at parking, you know, at shopping malls. You know, so the point I'm making is that we treat such cases, on case by case basis. We basically treat them on case by case basis because they differ.
What determines your action when a complainant has come over with a complaint regarding poor service?
Okay, first of all, we encourage consumers to lodge complaints with traders and service providers. We do not wish to get involved in some of these transactions, because we believe that businesses are responsible enough to ensure that they do not take advantage of consumers. At the same time, we believe consumers understand their rights, and in the event that those are abrogated, consumers have the power to go and seek redress. So first of all, what we are saying is that we encourage consumers to deal with the traders and service providers before they come to the commission. Consumers should only come to the commission when they have failed to resolve the complaints that they have against traders and service providers. In the event that they fail to resolve those complaints, that is when they should come to the commission. We would like to encourage self-regulation among traders and service providers. Do not wait for the commission to get involved, because once we get involved, you might lose, because we are talking about financial penalties here of a maximum of 10% of your annual turnover. So the best that you can do is resolve the complaint that comes to you from a consumer before they escalate it to the commission. Because once it has escalated to the commission, the assumption is that you have failed to redress the consumer. And so since you have failed to redress a consumer, we will then get involved. And like I say, once we get involved, it gets serious and it's going to impact on your profitability. We don't want businesses to spend much of their time, resolving complaints, trying to redress complaints, or coming to the commission to explain themselves. We'd like you to spend much of your time, growing your businesses, making profits, and not spending much of your time attending court because you have supplied the consumer with an expired product. Will not hesitate to prosecute you, to take you to court. The time that you spend in court can be used to grow your business.
Mr. Lingera, thank you so much for having time to talk to us on your platform.
Most welcome. Thank you.
On that note, we come to the end of this week's edition of Your Platform, where we've been looking at consumer rights. How well do you know your rights as a consumer? This has been Macpherson Mukuka. On behalf of my camera person, Shirika Kalenga, it's goodbye and God bless you.